We know that housing is a critical link in modern life. Without safe, decent, and affordable housing, any person is at a serious disadvantage to live out or seek the American dream. Our homes, whatever shape they take, are where we sleep at night, where we keep our medications, where we retreat after a stressful day of work, or for many LGBT people, after searching for work. Absent a place to call home, none of us can do any of these things productively. And if we find ourselves having to rebuild our lives, a home serves as a base of operations to getting us back on our feet. These concepts are part of the progressive principles that the task force uses to guide our work. And it is my honor today to introduce to you Secretary Shaun Donovan, a man who has applied the same principles to his career in public service. Because we are everywhere, and not just places like San Francisco or Washington or New York. We're in places like Lake County, Montana, and in the deep south, like Pearl River County, Mississippi. We are literally everywhere. We cross all racial, religious, gender, and class backgrounds. We are woven into the fabric of American life and integral to its past, present, and frankly, its future success. And that's what the task force is fighting for down the road in Washington and in places across the country as well. We know that LGBT people, especially transgender people, face devastating discrimination in housing, employment, and in education. One of the findings of our National Transgender Discrimination Survey, which we conducted with our colleagues at the National Center for Transgender Equality, was a disproportionate, alarming amount of homelessness experienced by transgender people. And anecdotally, we know that the rest of the LGBT community, especially young people, also experience shockingly high levels of homelessness and housing discrimination. That's why we need leadership like Secretary Donovan, who has been leading a leading and very loud champion for LGBT rights. Since taking the helm, Secretary Donovan has launched efforts to study LGBT housing discrimination. He's announced proposed regulations to protect LGBT people and families in HUD-funded programs and require recipients of HUD grants to comply with state and local non-discrimination laws that cover sexual orientation and gender identity. Because of Secretary Donovan's leadership, we have moved the ball forward in giving LGBT people and our families the tools to fight back against discrimination. And I encourage all of you to contact HUD, to let them know that you appreciate what they're doing. Goodness knows they hear from people who do not want us to have homes. And go check them out. All you need to do is Google HUD, LGBT, and rights. All the stuff pops up. This is the commitment that Secretary Donovan has had in his decades of public service. From his time in New York City, launching the New Marketplace Plan to develop and preserve 165,000 affordable homes, to his work with the Millennial Housing Commission, Secretary Donovan has committed to developing smart, economical plans for affordable housing. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that Secretary Donovan is also the first cabinet-level secretary to speak at a national transgender event when he delivered remarks at the National Center for Transgender Equality's event last November. This is a man I would look up to. This is a man I would look up to. Without further delay, it is my extreme pleasure to introduce to all of you, Secretary of Housing, and Urban Development, Shaun Donovan.
Thank you. So wonderful to be with you today. Ray, thank you for that very kind introduction. I am a little mad at you though, Ray, putting me right after Kate Clinton. I want to promise from you that next year, when I come to Atlanta to speak, and I'm still Secretary of Housing, you're going to let me go before Kate Clinton, all right? Thank you. Seriously, and you all know this, Ray reminds us, each of us here today, what a privilege it is to be partners in the fight for equality for the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community. And it's an enormous honor to be here as the very first sitting cabinet secretary in history to address the task force and to speak at creating change. Let me also thank the board and staff of the task force for inviting me, and many of my colleagues from across the Obama administration to participate in this conference. Thanks to your leadership in convening the New Beginning Initiative, together we've made extraordinary progress, creating changes throughout the administration that have improved the day-to-day lives of LGBT people across the country. The progress we've made together reminds me that President Obama views the fight for LGBT equality not as an issue, but as a priority. You can see this commitment in the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. In his very first State of the Union, the President called for its repeal. And Tuesday night this week, an active duty Air Force colonel who is openly lesbian sat at the President's third State of the Union address as a guest in the First Lady's box without fear of being discharged for who she is or who she loves. Woo! You can see that commitment in a record number of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender appointments to positions throughout the administration. You can see it in a presidential memorandum on hospital visitation, which addressed the rights of patients in hospitals that receive Medicare or Medicaid funds. That's just about every hospital in the country. To designate visitors regardless of sexual orientation or gender identity, and directing the Secretary of Health and Human Services, my good friend Kathleen Sebelius, to take the necessary steps to improve the health and well-being of LGBT people and their families. You can see it in the efforts we've undertaken on behalf of the transgender community. From the State Department's efforts to ensure greater dignity and privacy for transgender passport applicants, to the Office of Personnel Management's announcement that gender identity is a prohibited basis of discrimination in federal employment, to the VA's directive to ensure respectful and non-discriminatory care for transgender veterans who deserve our deepest gratitude and our commitment to their well-being. You can also see it in a presidential memorandum promoting the protection of the human rights of LGBT individuals abroad, and in Secretary of State Clinton's bold and forceful declaration that gay rights are human rights, and that all people deserve to be treated with dignity and respect. Perhaps clearest of all, you can see the President's commitment in the Matthew Shepard and James Byrd Jr. Hate Crimes Prevention Law. I am so proud to work for the President who signed the first federal civil rights legislation that includes the words sexual orientation and gender identity into law. That is our President. Now I'm here this afternoon because our President and all of us in his administration believe the LGBT community deserves a place at the table, and also a place to call home. Each of us here knows that rights most folks take for granted are routinely violated against LGBT people. That's why I'm proud to stand before you this afternoon and say that HUD has been a leader in the fight, your fight and my fight for equality. Over the last 3 years, we've worked to ensure that our housing programs are open, not to some, not to most, but open to all. Now, some outside this room might ask, why is that even necessary? Well, let me tell you about Mitch and Michelle Deshane. 2 years ago, Michelle wanted to add her partner Mitch, a transgender man, to the housing voucher she receives to find affordable housing. The local housing authority denied her request. They told her that the couple didn't meet its definition of family. Then, the Deshanes were referred to a neighboring housing authority because, as they were apparently told, and I quote here, that housing authority accepts everyone, even Martians. That is just wrong. No one should be subject to that kind of treatment or denied access to housing assistance because of their sexual orientation or gender identity. Justice at Every Turn report you put out last year with the National Center for Transgender Equality showed these challenges are all too common. That report found not only that a staggering 40% of homeless youth are LGBT, but that half of them report experiencing homelessness as a direct result of their gender identity or expression. Even more troubling, the majority report harassment, difficulty, or even sexual assault when trying to access homeless shelters. Allowing this mistreatment to happen is not only wrong, it's not who we are as Americans. That's why for the first time in our annual National Fair Housing Policy Conference, HUD hosted a session on housing discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. It's why in December, HUD and HHS held the first ever LGBT Elder Housing Summit, bringing together advocates and practitioners from across the country to highlight existing barriers and explore future opportunities to support housing and long-term care designed specifically for seniors in the LGBT community. It's why we're conducting the first ever national study of LGBT housing discrimination, a historic and important study we designed based on feedback from town halls conducted in communities across the country. Led by our great HUD Assistant Secretary Raphael Bostic, this study is partly about getting a clearer picture of the problem, but it's also about making the case that LGBT discrimination is real and that we need to do something about it. That's why we've been reviewing our existing authority to address housing discrimination related to the LGBT community. For instance, under the Fair Housing Act's prohibition of sex discrimination, we have authority to pursue cases alleging housing discrimination because a person's identity or expression didn't conform with gender stereotypes. And we've also provided HUD staff with guidance instructing them to carefully assess whether any LGBT-based housing discrimination complaints could be pursued through the Fair Housing Act or state or local discrimination laws. And we've launched a webpage on LGBT housing discrimination. We know that these efforts are already having an impact. With these resources, we're helping to uncover discrimination that had gone unreported far too long, and raising awareness that reporting such discrimination can make a real difference. As a result, not only have reports of LGBT housing discrimination increased, so have the number of complaints that we've been able to move forward on. We've also required grant applicants to comply with state and local anti-discrimination laws that include sexual orientation or gender discrimination. covering 20 states and more than 4 in 10 Americans call those states home. Over $3 billion of federal funding is available in these HUD grants alone, and we want to make sure as many dollars as possible are protecting the rights of every American. Just as we're making sure we understand the needs of LGBT Americans, we're also making sure that LGBT Americans understand their rights as well. With HUD's Live Free, Fair Housing, Education, and Outreach campaign, we've been targeting print and social media like Facebook with videos, podcasts, and ads that address discrimination and let people know how to report it. These are the first steps we've taken to ensure that all Americans, regardless of age, income, race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, or gender identity, have access to choice and opportunity. But I tell you today, they aren't the last. And so today, I am proud to announce a new equal access to housing rule that says clearly and unequivocally that LGBT individuals and couples have the right to live where they choose. To get it across the finish line. I also have to say thank you to the task force and other LGBT organizations for the feedback you provided us when we solicited comment on the proposed rule. As you can imagine, we were expecting our critics out on the right to come after us. Overwhelmingly, the comments we got applauded this rule. And that's thanks to you and the coalition, the movement that you've built across this country. Now, when we first proposed this rule, we included a provision that prohibited owners and operators of HUD housing from inquiring whether someone is LGBT. But as your comments made very clear, people won't have to inquire to discriminate against them. That often, people face discrimination based on their appearance or manners. And so first and foremost, this rule includes a new equal access provision that prohibits owners and operators of HUD-funded housing or housing whose financing we insure from inquiring about an applicant's sexual orientation or gender identity or denying housing on that basis. If you're denying HUD housing to people on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity, or perceived, you're discriminating. You're breaking the law, and you will be held accountable. That's what equal access means, and that's exactly what this rule is going to do. Secondly, this rule makes clear that LGBT families, like the Deschaines, are eligible for HUD's public housing and housing choice voucher programs that collectively serve 5.5 million families across this country. Third, the rule also makes clear that sexual orientation and gender identity should not and cannot be part of any lending decision when it comes to getting a mortgage insured by the FHA, which is part of HUD. And when you think about the fact that 40% of Americans who bought homes last year in this country, 60% of African Americans and Latinos who bought homes used an FHA mortgage, that is real progress. this rule will be published as final in the Federal Register next week and go into effect 30 days later. It was published initially for comment on my birthday last year. It was quite a birthday present. And it will be official and final just a month from now. But let's be clear. Publishing this rule next week won't be the end of the process. But in many ways, just the beginning. Enacting a rule is not enough. Training and education are essential to ensuring those rules are followed in communities across the country. And so HUD and our fair housing partners will work to provide guidance and training on the substance of this rule and the impact it will have for both how we administer HUD programs and also how we enforce our nation's fair housing laws more broadly. And we look forward to working with every one of you on that education effort. For me, and for my colleagues here today, and for President Obama, everything I've described is fundamentally about one goal, which I know is familiar to every one of you, creating change. Change like the President, acknowledging young black gay men's struggles, and telling these men that their lives matter. Change like a commitment to double down on our efforts to ensure the promise that we can live in an AIDS-free generation. Yeah. Or when the President acts to protect the visitation rights of gay and lesbian patients. Because no one should be separated from the person they love, not in sickness, and not in health. Change is a returning sailor sharing a traditional first kiss with her girlfriend. An Air Force officer having her partner at her side when she gets promoted. And a Marine introducing his boyfriend to his battle buddies at the Marine Corps ball. Change is present in the first state and members of the administration telling young people across the country that bullying is wrong, their lives matter, and it does get better. Change the world in which a young man like Matthew Shepard can grow up, fall in love, and live happily ever after. Because the President signed into law the first piece of federal legislation in history containing the words sexual orientation and gender identity. And because his government is acting to bring us closer to a day when hate crimes on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity are history. That's right. And change is President Obama and all of us in his administration standing for equal rights under the law for committed gay and lesbian couples by informing the courts that Section 3 of the so-called Defense of Marriage Act is unconstitutional. Now let's be honest here with each other. I can be as frustrated as anyone by the pace of change. Change is slow, and change is hard. But the change I've been talking about, this change is real. It didn't just happen. It took vigilance and commitment from you, from the President, and from every one of us in his administration. As many of you may know, President Obama had inscribed on the carpet in the Oval Office a quote that I love, a quote of Martin Luther King's, which reads, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." At moments when change is hard and his head is bowed, I often imagine President Obama looking down and seeing these words, and remembering to keep his eyes on the prize. I mention that quote not just because I believe the progress I've described over these last 3 years proves its truth, but also because we didn't come this far because we hoped that arc would bend. We got this far because of people throughout our proud history, people like Val Burke, Mitch and Michelle Duchesne, and the countless others whose names we'll never know, because they had the strength and the courage to lean on that arc and inspire others to do the same. Because the kind of change we need can't be led by Washington. It never is. It's got to be led by people, as President Obama has said, by ordinary citizens, propelled not just by politics, but by love and friendship and a sense of mutual regard. It's got to be led by every one of you, by me, by all of us. There are no sidelines in this fight. Like our president, I believe America succeeds when everyone gets a fair shot, when everyone does their fair share, and when everyone plays by the same rules. Those are our values as Americans. They represent who we are, and from the beginning of the founding of this nation, who we aspire to be as we seek to create a more perfect union. So let's make that happen. Let's keep creating change this year, next year, and every year going forward. Thank you for having me here today. Thank you for the privilege of serving with each and every one of you. I know you will keep up this fight in the days and weeks and years ahead. And President Obama and I will be standing by your side each step of the way. Thank you. Thank you.